IB started very well with a fantastic weather, but to be sincere with you, what happened actually was the traffic was a little intensive. So a number of us were not able to make it at 9. We will take that for an excuse, but I believe that we owe the Institute a couple of assignments that we'll have to do at will. Good morning, everyone. My name is Ken Kabunu. I'm going to be your master of ceremony, and I must be honest to say that geoscience is the study of the Earth's history, for which I have explained that we went through some natural causes, which was quite exogenous. And having realized that, I believe that we need to stand on four pillars, and that brings love to this wonderful unity. And by that, we have four chairs that needs to be occupied by four great personalities. The first one, the sitting president, Mrs. Alexandra Amwaku-Mensah. Please, let's give her a round of applause to take a seat. We'd like to also invite Dr. P.C. Akwa to take a seat as well. And of course, our Honorable Alhaji would like to invite you to take a seat with a round of applause. Professor Richard Amankwa, please, would like to ask you to also take a seat with a round of applause. Ladies and gentlemen, at this moment, I'd like to invite Reverend Sam Wood to say the opening prayer. Yes, Father. Let me bring the microphone to my own Reverend Father.
Let us pray. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Merciful Father, giver of life, giver of all good things, we thank you for bringing us in here this morning to witness the inaugural ceremony that we have with the institution. People, those who are on their way coming, journey mercies, as you brought us in here amidst even traffic. Help us, O Lord, as we have this program to go through. We pray for your Holy Spirit to be with us, direct every aspect of this program. That success will be crowned. We pray this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you very much, Reverend Father Wood. Please put your hands together for him. We'd like to invite Mr. Isaac Ajovu to introduce the chairman for today. Please put your hands together. Of the 90s. Friends, environment. And experts on the environmental component of sustainable development and the new partnership for African development, NEPAD. As UNEP official, he worked extensively with, among others, the African Union, the new partnership for African Development Agency, and to a relatively limited extent, the African Development Bank. This collaborative work between AMSEM and these three key African institutions and UNEP mainly involve the preparation and implementation of the comprehensive NEPAD Environmental Action Plan, as well as African preparation and participation in the global climate change negotiations. Our chairman also periodically serves as an independent consultant with the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa, UNECA, from 2011 to 2015 on matters related to the effective participation of African policymakers and negotiators at the global climate change negotiations. He also worked as a regional coordinator
for capacity development and leakages for environmental impact assessment, EIA, in Africa from 2002 to 2003. He is a recipient of an international award for the services he rendered to the development of EIA in Africa. In Ghana, he worked as the last executive director of the Environmental Protection Council from February to December 2004, and the first executive director of the Environmental Protection Agency from December 1994 to December 2001, a total of 8 years. He concurrently served as a project director for the implementation of Ghana Environmental Resource Management Plan from 1994 to 1998. During his tenure as head of Ghana's EPA, two key matters were made legal requirements in the country, namely environmental impact assessment for applicable undertakings and the posting of reclamation bond by mining companies based on approved work plan for reclamation. During this period, our chairman led EPA to receive two institutional awards, a national and international award. He taught a number of courses in mineral processing, mineral appraisal, surface chemistry, and geochemistry at the university level from 1983 to 1994. He worked as director for monitoring and evaluation of Ghana's Minerals Commission from September 1986 to January 1994. He worked in the mining industry as a research metallurgist from 1994 to 1997, gaining valuable experience in industrial gold processing. Our chairman has extensive experience in environmental management and administration, the mineral industry, and the environmental advocacy work in Africa. In particular, he has served on a number of boards as well as international and national committees. He is a fellow of the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists, a member of International Associations of Impact Assessment, IAIA, among others. He has a PhD degree in mineral technology from the Imperial College of Science and Technology, University of London, and a master's degree and diploma of Imperial College, DIC, in mineral process design from the same university. His first degree is in geology from the University of Ghana, and he has also undertaken inter-allied certificate and fellowship courses in environmental management at University of Luleå, Sweden, and University of Bath in the United Kingdom, respectively. In this period where the whole country is crying loud in respect of effect of galamsey on our environment, we need someone with an in-depth knowledge on the effect of mining on the environment. And there is no other person, ladies and gentlemen, friends of the media, than our chairman. Join me to welcome our chairman for this special inaugural ceremony of the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists, Mr. Peter Akwa. Chairman, your audience, chairman.
Thank you very much.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we shall take a response from our chairman.
Yeah, thank you very much. Good morning to you. Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Ayobu, for the kind words. President of the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists, members of the council, fellows and members of the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists, members of the press media, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, all protocol observed. This special inaugural ceremony of the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists with the theme Responsible Management of Ghana's Natural Resources is very important for a number of reasons. I therefore feel honored to be requested to chair this event, which I accept. I'm delighted that the foundation of this institution has been laid firmly by the founding fathers and mother. Mrs. Alexandra Mwaku Mensah, a founding mother, has held the fort for many years and will soon hand over the presidency to another illustrious member of the institution, Alhaji Yakubu Idrisu. Please join me in thanking Mrs. Mwaku Mensah for her selfless service to First Geological Society of Ghana and subsequently to the institution. Please join me. I also wish to thank all those who have worked to support and all advanced the work of the institution over the years. Special mention is made of the outgoing executive members of the institution. Thanks. I intend to be brief in my opening remarks. However, as a geoscientist and an environmentalist, I must express my concern about the status of a country's environment, the natural environment in particular. Ghana's natural resources are being overexploited to meet socioeconomic needs, and as a result, irreparable damage has been and is being done to some productive lands through deforestation, air and water pollution, desertification, overgrazing, and destruction of biodiversity. Second, national environment policy. To buttress this point, Ghana's Shared Growth and Development Agenda, GSGDA, put the estimated total economic cost of poor environmental management and sanitation at over 10% GDP in 2010. Ladies and gentlemen, the impact of galamsey on the country's environment has taken the environmental degradation of Ghana to a higher level of decline. The country is currently facing an environmental crisis which requires us all to be actively involved in addressing the environmental challenges. Clean and healthy rivers are generally good indicators of the health of a country's environment. Ghana's rivers and some of the country's other water bodies have been and are being highly degraded, particularly through illegal mining. Small-scale mining does not have to be so destructive to our lands and rivers, particularly if, among others, sound policies and the scientific or technical underpinnings to mining are followed. This is where I see the role of the institution, and for that matter, geoscientists, in helping to address the current environmental challenges. Obviously, sound management and practices in artisanal small-scale mining can be achieved if, among others, geoscientists are made to be, one, actively involved in prospecting and the demarcation of areas for artisanal small-scale mining. Secondly, advising on the mining and processing of the mined material, and thirdly, advising on sustainability in that sector. Finally, I urge the incoming executive of the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists to lead the institution to, inter alia, fully participate in the sustainable use of a country's land and its resources, particularly in the mineral resources sector, if I may say, including oil and gas, of course. I wish all of us fruitful discussions and a successful event. Thank you very much.
Well, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the reason why I would ask for a second round of applause for the chairman is the fact that he touched on one very sensitive area, which is the environment. If you talk about degradation, it starts with a D, so you need a very determined society to fight this cause. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce a very beautiful woman who is among us this morning. Her name is one that starts with an A, and she has a lot of abilities. She holds a master's degree in philosophy, an MPhil in geochemistry from the Leeds University UK, and a master's of science in geology from the Leningrad University USSR. She has a post certificate in ceramic science and technology at the Alfred University, New York, United States of America, and a senior management development certificate from the Ghana Institute of Management and Public Administration, GIMPA, Accra. Among many other professional qualifications, she is an old girl of Wegehe. Please put your hands together. Wesley Gales High School, Cape Coast. With work experience, she was a geologist at Geological Survey Department, now Geological Survey Authority of Ghana, from 1966 to 1972, and rose to be the head of the GSD Mineralogical Laboratories at the head office here in Accra and at Salt Pond in the Central Region. She also worked with the Industrial Research Institute, IRI, and of the Council of Science and Industrial Research, CSIR, from 1972 to 1997, and she was the head of the material science section from 1984 to 1987. She was later promoted to become the director of the institute from 1987 to 1997. She also served as a director at the CSIR head office from 1997 until her compulsory retirement in 2000. She has served on several international and local committees and boards, including the following: United Nations Scientific and Technical Committee on the International Decade for Natural Disaster Reduction, Boards of Directors of Clay Products Limited, Boards of Director, Board of Director, Ghana Broadcasting Corporation, GBC, 1991-94, Board of Directors of the Ghana National Petroleum Corporation, GNPC, Board of Directors of the Minerals Commission, member of the Governing Council of GNPC Learning Foundation to date. Please put your hands together for her. She has served as a Secretary General of the Geological Society of Africa 1988-1993 and facilitated the process of affiliation of the Ghana Institute of Geoscientists with the American Association of Petroleum Geoscientists. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, shall we welcome Mrs. Alexandra Amwaku Mensah, a consultant in the management of industrial minerals and has extensive 40 years experience. And to be very sincere with you, she is a woman of honor. Please put your hands together.
Thank you very much for the kind words. Mr. Chairman, members of the Council of Ghana Institution of Geoscientists, the outgoing Executive Committee, members of our newly elected Executive Committee, fellows, and members of the institution, special guests, ladies and gentlemen, all protocol duly observed. On this occasion of the inauguration of the new Executive Committee of the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists, permit me to express my sincere gratitude, first of all, to God, and praise Him for giving us strength to be here today, and also to the electoral body for the conduct of a smooth and successful process to usher in new officers to steer the affairs of our cherished institution. My sincere thanks also go to the colleague members of the outgoing Executive Committee, their resourcefulness, sacrifice, effort, and dedication in steering the affairs of the institution through a critical phase in its development. Dr. Turner, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, as we speak, our membership database has been established to provide basis for the better planning and resource mobilization for the continued growth and development of the institution. Furthermore, our financial records have been streamlined to facilitate the preparation of annual accounts. Indeed, we now have our audited financial statements up to the year ending 31st December 2016. From humble beginnings, the GHIG, that is the institution, has now taken possession of a parcel of land situated at Dodua, near Accra, for the development of new offices to facilitate the operations of our secretariat, as well as other activities of the institution. Our most sincere gratitude goes to the management and staff of the Geological Society, Geological Survey Authority of Ghana, for accommodating the institution on its premises over the years. We are most grateful. Our membership drive has continued, especially to attract students and new graduates into our fold as a means of facilitating the holistic development of the country's human capacity base in the geosciences. In this respect, we've been able to maintain 3 academic awards to deserving graduates at the University of Ghana and at the University of Mines and Technology, TAQA. Colleagues, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, when we assumed office, our stated primary focus, however, was to encourage our membership to add value to themselves, not just by enhancing their expertise in specialized areas within the geosciences, but by pursuing diverse skills and knowledge in areas such as business management, law, finance, and accounting, you just name it, in order to retain relevant, to remain relevant and marketable in the broader economic development of the country. I believe this campaign, though quite challenging, still remains important for the growth and development of our membership, and it is heartwarming to know that increasingly, some of our members are developing themselves in areas noted above. The executive committee was also able to institute technical seminars as a means of supporting and enhancing the continuous education and professional development of members. The highlights of these seminars include the following. There's a tall list, I will just mention 2. A session on adjacent maritime boundary delineation, the case of Ghana. This was delivered by our brother Lawrence Apasi of the Ghana National Continental Shelf Delineation Project. He was with GNPC, now he's at the ministry. A resource member with the occasional participation of considerable going to be asking for them to look for outcomes from our executive. I think we are not going to continue to do that. I know. But rather, the concern, collaborative efforts of all of us will end us all. We will have considerable challenges with the management of our secretariat. We still have considerable challenges with the management of our secretariat, fundraising, and the full functionality of our standing committees. But we can surmount them if we tackle them with renewed energy, through dedication, unity, and teamwork. To our distinguished new executive members, once again, I say congratulations. I wish to assure you of the support of the outgoing team. We are confident, however, that you will assiduously uphold the image of the institution. Long live, Then it means most of the things I said were not heard properly. Sorry about that one. Long live Ghana Institution of Geoscientists. Long live Ghana. And nowadays, I realize when we do meet, we hardly mention the motto of the institution. When we started, yes, please turn to your program. I think it's there. When we started, anytime we meet, we tend to repeat this several times before we go. The president will say, to the earth, and our response is, for its wealth. So let's, you know, establish that. To the earth. To the earth. And to the earth. Thank you for your attention, and God bless all of us.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, every reminder is a gift of treasure, and therefore we should give her a second round of applause. So far, so good, and everything is in place. I'd like to invite one lady lecturer from the University of Ghana, Dr. Yvonne Low, to introduce the guest speaker. Please put your hands together.
To the earth. Thank you, madam. Thank you for the reminder. Mr. Chair, former president of the institution, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, and all protocol duly observed. I am delighted to be called upon to introduce our speaker for the day. He's a distinguished professor in minerals engineering at UMAT and currently the dean of the Faculty of Mineral Resources and Technology. An alumni of KNUST. He acquired his bachelor's degree and went on to Clausthal, University of Clausthal in Germany, and then to the Queen's University in Canada for his PhD in 2005. Our speaker for the day is a distinguished scholar of international repute and has received several appointments. He has also won several research grants from international organizations, including the World Bank, International Growth Center, UK, NSF, the National Science Foundation, USA, the European Union, and the British Council. He is the lead country researcher of the United Nations Project on Women in Artisanal Mining. His research interests include gold beneficiation, water quality and management, microwave processing of minerals, small-scale mining, medical geology, geometallurgy, microbial mineral recovery, and environmental biotechnology. Mr. Chair, this speaker is a member of the Ghana Institution of Engineers and Society for Mining, Metallurgy, and Petroleum Engineers of the USA. Ladies and gentlemen, kindly permit me to singularly invite our distinguished speaker of the day, Professor Richard Amankwa.
Thank you very much, Doctor. It's not every day that you get a beautiful lady to introduce you. And for this, I'm delighted. Coming here has been very interesting and humbling. And first of all, I would want to thank the executives for inviting me to be part of this ceremony. And as I said, in entering this room, I met the man who many years ago directed me to take minerals engineering as a course when I finished my sixth form education. Thank you for doing that, Mr. Ajumai. I also have met three very distinguished people in the field who I read about and admired so much in my early days in the profession. Thank you all very much for mentoring us. Mr. Chairman, the executives of this august organization, my boss, the Vice Chancellor of UMAT, honorable members of this distinguished group, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, members of the media, or Protocol of Z. This topic, I guess, has come at the right time for us to talk about responsible management of Ghana's natural resources. And I'll be doing that in the next few minutes. Ghana as a country is endowed with several natural resources, both renewable and non-renewable. And apparently, if a group like the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists invite you to talk about natural resources, I want to believe that they don't want me to talk about fisheries or about grass cutters or about teak plantations, but rather to talk about the non-renewable ones like minerals. And that is where I will direct my attention. Mr. Chairman, Ghana is endowed with several minerals. And a look through the geological map of Ghana would show that all over the country, there are deposits of minerals. We have bauxite in several areas, the Tiwa area, Yinehin, and even on the hills of Kanayerebo, where we have the Awaso, or the Ghana Bauxite Company. We have a lot of gold scattered around all the belts in the country. We have iron ore in three different areas with a total tonnage of more than 1 billion in Podu, in Sheini, and also in the Volta region. We have dimension stones that can be mined, diamonds, gold, several others. It means that in Ghana, wherever you can dig deep enough, most likely you get a mineral. The pegmatites are all available for us to exploit. Kulumbai tantalite, all around the coast for people to look at. But currently the ones that have gained a lot of attention happens to be gold, diamonds, bauxite, and manganese. And for these, we have mines. The United Nations defines a mineral economy as one that generates at least 10% of GDP from mining and 40% of foreign exchange earnings from the mineral exports. It means that though Ghana has a mineral system that contributes extensively, we are not yet a mineral economy, according to this definition, because our GDP hovers between 5% and 10%, and the exports hit 40 and drop again, and it has been working between 35 and 40. So we are not yet a mineral economy. But then the minerals industry contributes a lot to the development of the country. Talking about responsible management of natural resources, the literature brings several perspectives about the sector when it talks about responsible management. And one that I want to share with us is attributable to Dave Toyson, the president and CEO of World Vision, who talked about the fact that when we are looking at responsible management of natural resources, it includes respecting the environment. First of all, respecting the environment. And I believe Mr. Chairman here is a strong man in that area, the environment. It also talks about exceeding national and international norms regarding how to preserve the environment and taking proactive strategies also to conserve the environment. It talks about upholding the rights and perspectives of people and communities affected by mining. And this one is extremely important because in most of the communities that are affected by mining, you do not meet people who perhaps can engage the international community to negotiate a good deal. And that requires that the company makes an attempt not to take advantage of the people in the community. And it also requires that institutions like the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists help with communities or help these communities so that they are not taking advantage of when it comes to negotiating a good deal with our international partners. It talks about investing in the long-term development of the communities, the nation and the communities as a whole. Again, this is very important, especially if you have visited some of these old mining towns recently. If you drive through Pristia, some of these things will come to the fore very strongly. One would ask, after 200 years of mining, what has Pristia got to show? These are issues we will talk about later. This definition gives an impression that sustainable development is actually a subset of responsible management of natural resources. And therefore, for this discussion, we will look briefly at sustainable development and the issue of collaborative engagement leading to the development of healthier environments, healthier communities, and even disease control. The United Nations, according to the Brundtland Report, talks about sustainable development. as meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of the future generations to meet their own needs, unquote. So that I'm not accused of plagiarism. In the minerals industry where we deal with depletable materials, it becomes necessary to rethink how this definition applies to us, especially the issue of depletion. And therefore, this definition has been modified slightly for the minerals field, where we don't talk about depletion as such, but then leaving a legacy where the environment is not compromised on, where the economy of the society is developed, and where the social system is not disturbed. So once we are able to uphold these three pillars of sustainable development, then we are sure that we are contributing to the development of the country, and for that matter, the communities where the mining activities take place. And these three have to be integrated to be able to get the real deal. Mr. Chairman, we are looking at development that does not bring the natural environment to the tipping point. When I talk about tipping point, I'm looking at a scenario where exploitation of the mineral resources leaves the system or the environment in a very fragile state. For instance, anybody who has followed the emergence of Boruli ulcer in our system would realize that anywhere in Ghana where there is Boruli ulcer, it is preceded normally by land disturbance, by mining, of course. Either sand winning as it occurs in Amasan mine, or gold mining as it occurs in the Jinchura area. If you ever get a chance to follow the water quality of River Ofin, which I did some time ago, from its source in Huidiem at Mampong, if you track it through Boomai area, coming down to the Achima area, passing through Dunkwau, and joining River Pura at Erisem, around Asinfusu, you would realize that there are some areas where people can actually use a cup to fetch the water and drink, whilst in some areas it is virtually not possible even to walk through because of some of these activities. So in some of these areas, you realize that the environment has been pushed to a tipping point, and that is where diseases emerge. So when we talk about sustainable development, we are looking at a scenario where the minerals can be exploited without pushing the environment to a tipping point where disease can take over and begin to affect the inhabitants of those systems. We are looking at a situation where mineral exploitation will leave a legacy of clean water and productive farmlands. Again, we are looking at a scenario where mines will not leave behind several liabilities after closure. We also talk about scenarios where the wealth that is being generated is shared evenly between both the investor and the people who own the land. We have people who the land belongs to, and then people come in to borrow the land for a period to mine and to dig some materials out. But the question is, to what extent are the resources or the dividends shared equally? It appears that in our system, developing the communities is always an afterthought, and it is not taken into consideration during the planning stages of the mine. And therefore, our kind of corporate social responsibility has been limited to rearing of grass cutters and teaching ladies how to prepare tie and dye and batik. And that is why most of these sustainable development and livelihood options do not last in Ghana. Mr. Chairman, I dare ask that how will you convince a small-scale miner who can earn about $100 a day to start rearing grass cutters for the next 6 months before he starts selling them? What happens between then and the time he starts selling? How much is one grass cutter anyway? Even the ones that have been crucified on the Cape Coast, Accra Road. You see those gratitude that have been crucified like that. These are some of the challenges that we have to look at as we talk about sustainable development. Indeed, we have to consider creative compensation packages for people whose lands have been taken over. We are living in communities where people have cocoa farms, but then these cocoa farms may not necessarily belong to them, but to the family. So a mine takes over a cocoa farm and gives a lump sum to the person who at that time was the caretaker of that farm. A villager who has seen big money, the first thing that comes to mind is to marry another wife. He takes on two more wives. Within 2 years, the money is gone. What happens to the next generation of members of this family? Who takes them to school? In considering all these, it becomes clear that giving one-time compensation packages for some of these properties is not enough. But rather, we should look at collectively how to engage the community and to make sure that the generations coming after those who have received the lump sums do not suffer, but rather we position them in a situation where they can make something good out of their lives. This should be considered throughout the lifespan of the mine. And in considering the life cycle of a mine, we look at exploration, where people like your good selves would work. We look at the development stages, the planning, the development, the exploitation, on and on to closure and also post-closure. It is important that we factor into each of these steps or each of these sections in the life cycle of a mine issues about responsible management so that the communities do not suffer. For instance, we do a lot of prospecting, we do a lot of exploration. But the questions sometimes we ask ourselves is, who covers the pit that you dug when you were taking samples in somebody's cocoa farm? Is it possible for us to go back and cover those pits after we have taken the samples? What about the few cocoa trees that we cut away and nobody was looking, and therefore we ignored them? Do we know the number of cocoa pods that were to come after? It becomes necessary for all of us to rethink how we do things so that we do not leave pits behind that will collect water where mosquitoes can lay their eggs and come back to attack the community. Whilst we sit in our offices, the air-conditioned offices, and enjoy the booty, it is important for us to consider holistically how we can look at some of these things. Mr. Chairman, when you look at the scenario in Ghana here, whilst the mine is active, there are some benefits to the community. But even then, what are the benefits? Apart from the salaries that workers are paid and the taxes that government collects, what else really comes out of it? Is it possible, for instance, for us to look at the networks, the linkages of a typical mining community or industry, the things that they need, the forward ones, the backward, the sideways, especially the backward ones, the backward linkages? To what extent are Ghanaians contributing in these chains? Where do we produce helmets for the minerals industry? Where do we produce overalls for the minerals industry? What about the boots they wear on a daily basis? What percentage of that amount is generated by local industry? Is it not possible that we can make a strong case for local industries to take charge of some of these things, if not all?
Oh yes, we can always say that the quality of the goods are low. But then is it not possible for us to retool our local industries? For instance, you want me to produce a helmet. I produce the first one, the quality is low. Tell me what I should do extra to take it to the quality that you want. I do it a second time. Maybe I still do not meet your target. What about the third time? Possibly after doing it six times, I'll be able to meet the target. And then an industry is set up. In these days when we are talking about one district, one factory, I dare say that that would be the way to go. We should be able to establish places where people can develop helmets for the minerals industry. And possibly we can legislate that once the quality of the helmets we are producing in Ghana happens to be good, no helmets should come from outside. That becomes our trump card. What about their overalls? Can't we sew overalls in Ghana? Why should we continue to import overalls when we have tailors in Ghana? Can we set up a stream, a pool of tailors who can sew for the minerals industry? Perhaps they'll sew the first one, the quality is not good enough. What about the second one? What about the third one? Let's keep doing it until the quality becomes good enough. And once we can all agree that the quality is good, then we cut off importation of that item. We talk about the liberalized economy, yes. But how many people in Ghana here can export coat to the US market? Let us begin to think about national development in these areas. As I indicated earlier, corporate social responsibility for our companies is limited mainly to building of elementary school blocks and community centers and pipe stands and grass cutter rearing training programs and tie and dye batik training programs. You bet it. KVIPs. Mr. Chairman, I believe it is about time that companies begin to think about monumental projects, legacy projects. Is it not worth it to have a world-class hospital, for instance, in Pristia? Is it not worth it to have a world-class university in Takwa? We have one mining university in the whole of the West African sub-region. But the question is, to what extent is the minerals industry contributing to the running of this university? My vice chancellor is here. You go to the geology department of the University of Mines and Technology, and we cannot boast of more than two world-class microscopes. Meanwhile, the geology department alone has more than 200 students. And all other departments also learn all microscopy. And they process to get thin sections and polish sections and all the things you can think about. Why should we go begging for people to help us just to buy microscopes? I think it's about time that we move away from pipe stands to building world-class monumental items that we can call legacy projects for the minerals industry. Let us look at two towns, the tale of two cities, Johannesburg and Pristia. It may be of interest to know that mining in both towns perhaps started around the same time. But because of capital flight, if you go to Pristia today, you ask yourself, is this the Pristia that I heard about? Or it's another one? Is he who is to come, or we should look for another? Pristia is now like a God-forsaken place, a totally ghost-related environment, and it's because of capital flight. Can we begin to put in place policies that can prevent the development of these shanty towns? Can we keep part of the money in the towns? This is a question that we can all think about. It is important for us to move from standpipes to better things. At the moment, a model has been developed, which I refer to as the Merikujima model for corporate social responsibility. Mr. Chairman, this model talks about the fact that whilst a mine is in operation, a percentage of the money that is to be paid to the community should be put in an investment. And this money should not be touched so long as the mine exists, so that this money can accrue. And over the years, this money can be made available to members of the community several generations down the road, because perhaps the cocoa farm that was established by their great-great-great-grandfather is no longer available to them. The oil palm plantation that was established by their great-great-great-great-grandmother is no longer available to them. But then this fund is available to help them to pay their school fees and to help them to go into apprenticeship and, for that matter, any kind of institution that they want to attend, so long as it can be proven that they are indigenous of that community. This kind of fund, so long as it is put in a good high rate account, can be available so long as this community exists. Is it possible for us to replicate this model in other mining communities? Perhaps yes. And that is where the policy framework issues come in. Again, mining companies invest a lot to build a mine, especially from exploration right down to closure. A mine can invest up to about $2 billion from exploration to the time when they start pouring gold. Is it possible for us to engage these our partners for them to pay a percentage of this investment cost towards the development of the communities in which the mines are? For instance, if Newmont pays $2 billion to establish the mine, what is 5% of $2 billion? In the scheme of things, it's not too much when you compare it in terms of percentage. But 5% to the town of Kenyasi would be huge. It would be more than the $1 million one district issue. And therefore, if we are able to bring some of these things on board at the very early stages of mine development, then possibly we can get a lot of money accruing to the communities in which the mining activities take place, so that many generations down the road, even after the mine has closed down, we can be sure that there will be monumental items or buildings or units for the people to see. And in addition to that, members of the community can be so well educated that they can move to other sectors of the economy to look for jobs. Mr. Chairman, I cannot end this by not referring to this small-scale mining issue that is going on. There is a current outcry on issues surrounding small-scale and artisanal mining. People are calling for the total ban of the sector due to the widespread destruction of forests, farms, farmlands, and the pollution of water bodies. Are there any positives for the sector? Certainly. In terms of national value addition, the sector is much better than the large-scale system, because virtually any money generated by small-scale miners remain in Ghana. And therefore, it is a very important sector. In terms of job creation, yes, more than 1 million people are directly involved in the sector. In terms of local economic development, I dare say yes, because in many communities, the hospitals are built by Galamsey people, small-scale miners. Let me not use Galamsey, small-scale miners. In some communities, power to their community were established by small-scale miners. In terms of foreign exchange generation, yes, because they are producing more than 30% of total gold in Ghana, and perhaps all the diamonds that Ghana produces are from the small-scale activities. If you are wearing a ring, be thankful to the small scale miner, especially if it is gold. Because you cannot buy gold from Anglo Gold Ashanti. Neither can you buy gold from Gold Fields or Golden Star. Because they don't sell their gold locally. And therefore, any gold you buy in Ghana is definitely from the small scale mining sector. It has helped with the evolution of indigenous entrepreneurs and enterprises. Definitely, we cannot lose sight of the environmental challenges. There are senseless activities sometimes, especially the Galamse, where you have dredges sitting on rivers, and the way they mine, leading to excessive land degradation. It is of interest to note, Mr. Chairman, that gold processing or gold output in small-scale mining has moved from 2% in 1989 to about over 30%, the highest being 34% in 2014. If you look at it from the United Nations perspective, where one person who is economically active affects six other people, it means that small-scale mining is taking care of 25% of Ghanaians. And therefore, it is a sector that we should not toy with. The question is, what is the way forward for small-scale mining? Sometimes I ask myself, how come nobody has a legal concession on rivers, and yet we have all looked on for people to pollute River Ofin, River Pra, River Bia, River Tano, and even the Volta. But nobody has a legal concession on a river. It has been said that the Minerals Commission is like the DVLA. They issue licenses, but they don't enforce their usage. You don't see any DVLA officer standing by the roadside enforcing that you drive with a license or your car should have roadworthy certificate. So sometimes the question is, why are we all blaming Minerals Commission? Hassan al-Hassan, he is happy. But let me take the other side of the story. The other side of the story is, when the degradation was going on, and these Minerals Commission officers were in the districts, and they were seeing it, what did they do? Did they get the courage to go to these illegal sites and tell them that, look, you don't have legal access to this land, and therefore stop working? Did they do that? When the people did not respond to them, what else did they do? Can we contact the Navy, for instance, for them to conduct an operation on all rivers in Ghana, destroy all dredges, because none of them is legal? What about the people at Achiasi in jungle warfare? What are they doing when we have people destroying our forests? Can't they team up with forest guards to bring sanity in our forests? Is that not possible? Sometimes as we think about these things, it appears as if it's something like this old adage where somebody was supposed to do somebody something and nobody did it expecting that somebody else could do it. We are all guilty. Because believe me, in the practice of engineering, in the real practice of engineering, if you are passing by and you see somebody conducting an unsafe act and you do not educate the person, if that person gets hurt, you are responsible. In North America, if you are a practicing engineer and somebody gets hurt and it is even known that you passed by at the time when the person was acting, your license will be revoked. Ghana Institution of Geoscience. Ghana Institution of Engineers, West African Institute of Mining and Metallurgy. I think this is our time. This is our time, as the president said. Let us team up and work together to bring some sanity in the sector. This sanity and this responsible mining, the small-scale mining sector, will come when there's political will, first of all. Because without political will, nothing will happen. Indeed, if you go to our books, Ghana has some of the best laws and regulations on small-scale mining. And they are in files. But if there is political will, then it will be important for us to look at, first of all, education, very important, and technology development. The truth of the matter is that if you have about 80% of people disobeying a law, you can never enforce it. Else all our prisons will be locked up, full. And therefore, if you have about 80% of all small-scale miners doing the wrong thing, you cannot enforce it. The way to go is education. Education, education, and more education. And once you keep educating and introducing new technology, and it begins to catch up, then the people who have adopted the education and the new technology would help us to enforce the law that we are talking about. It is important that we get to know that somebody can sit in Accra and pronounce that all small-scale mining activities should cease. I believe that. And I think that is one of the ways to go. But sometimes I question myself, how do you enforce that law in Botiboni? Do you know where Botiboni is? It becomes necessary for us to get the enforcement in place, and it should go side by side with the education, so that as we declare on the ground to something will be going on. I'm talking about education, I'm talking about enforcement, I'm talking about engagement, I'm talking about empowerment and attitudinal change in the sector. In this direction, I would like to say that UMAT has been doing very well. My vice chancellor is here. In terms of education, for the past year or so and over, we have an MOU with the Ghana National Association of Small-Scale Miners. We have an MOU with the Minerals Commission, and we got a grant, and we have trained several small-scale miners, moving from one district to the other, all the 9 small-scale mining districts. And even now, we are yet to do more, so long as a sponsoring agency and comes in the horizon. Now that we are talking about a ban on small-scale mining, I'm talking about the fact that there should be somebody on the ground to be able to do this. And is it possible that it can be one of the key performance indicators of these newly appointed district and municipal chief executives, that if small-scale mining activities go on in your territory, you have to step down, because they are the leaders of the district mining committees? Is that possible? These are things I want to raise for us to talk about and to discuss beyond this ceremony and this program, so that together we can all team up and help to bring about responsible mining, both in our large scale and small scale mining activities. Thank you very much for your attention.
Oh, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please let's give a round of applause to the chairman to conduct an induction at this moment. Please put your hands together for him. We will be inducting the new executives, so please, that's going to be first before we invite Mrs. Abuano. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, with a round of applause, also acknowledge the presence of Professor J.S. Kumar, Vice Chancellor of the University of Mines and Technology, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the chairman will at this moment induct the president. So please put your hands together. These are the procedures that you have to follow, and anything that has to do with science, you definitely must follow order.
Come to a very important part of the program, and I'll firstly ask the president-elect to raise his hand holding the constitution of the institution and repeat after me. Sorry for the mix-up. We don't have the right document. So repeat after me. I,
Alhaji Yakubu Idrisu,
holding Ghana Institution of Geosciences registration number.
Holding Ghana Institution of Geoscientist registration number 001.
Do hereby take this oath today, Thursday, 27th day of April 2017.
Do hereby take this oath today, Thursday, 27th day of April 2017.
That I accept the high office of the fifth president.
Duly elected under the Constitution of Ghana Institution of Geosciences. Duly elected under the Constitution of Ghana Institution of Geosciences.
That I will work diligently to uphold the tenets of the institution.
That I will work diligently to uphold the tenets of the institution.
That I will observe the professional ethics that go with this high office.
That I will observe the professional ethics that go with this high office.
And that I will continue with the good works of my predecessors.
And that I will continue with the good works of my predecessors.
I will work with the council and executive to deliver accordingly.
I will work with the council and executives to deliver accordingly.
So help me God. So help me God.
Congratulations, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. At this moment, the new president will induct the new executives. Please put your hands together. We'd like to invite, you have the list right on. Once again, a round of applause for Alhaji Yakubu Idrisu, current president. Dr. Daniel Buama, Vice President 1. Professor Daniel Asiedu, Second Vice President. Jacob Asari, Third Vice President. Raymond K.D. Ferdo, General Secretary. Chrysla Akwe Ankra, Assistant General Secretary. Savior Alomatu, Treasurer. Dr. Anthony Dua, Financial Secretary. Samuel Togan, Public Affairs Officer. Is a round of applause for them. Before the swearing in, we will go straight on to decorate the current president. Congratulations, we will go ahead with the induction of the current executives. Applaud him again. Well, the details has been well taking on. Oh yeah, the Minerals Commission will embark on serious education. We all will be involved.
Yeah, thank you very much. I have a small announcement to make. The following persons are not with us for one reason or another, compelling reason or another, so they'll be sworn in later. They are Professor Daniel Asiedu, Dr. Daniel Boama, and Raymond Depet. So at another occasion, we will swear them in. Now, you ready? Yeah. President?
Okay.
You said this for the first time.
So you say after me, I an executive member, you mentioned a registration number, do hereby take this oath today. That is the 27th day of April 2017. That I accept the position of duly elected under the Constitution of Ghana Institution of Joint Scientists. That I will work diligently to uphold the good name of the institution. That I will observe faithfully the professional ethics that go with this high office. And that I will continue with the good works of my predecessors. I will support the President, the Council, and colleague executives in the discharge of my duties. So help me God.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen,
For every mile and for every journey, we have a reason to embark on. There's always a fact to contain that continuity must be pursued. On that score, I'd like to invite the current president, Alhaji Yakubu Idrisu, to deliver his address. Please give him a round of applause.
Mr. Chairman, immediate Vice President of the institution, distinguished guests, the Vice Chancellor of UMass, fellows and members of the institution, ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you to this morning's ceremony. In fact, with the office new executive members of the institution. Today's ceremony comes off amidst government and public outcry against the rampant destruction of the natural environment caused by illegal mining. We salute the Honorable Minister for Lands and Natural Resources for the bold initiative he has taken to this manners. At least they have shown a political will. As geoscientists, we cannot pretend to be unaware of this looming natural disaster. Let us collectively resolve to assist the government in averting this disaster. I'm grateful to all for electing me to lead the Ghana Institution of Geosciences. I'm deeply humbled by your choice, and at the same time, I must admit that the institution is facing major challenges that call for unity and total involvement of each member and each one of us. In other words, all hands on deck. I intend during the tenure of my office to build on the foundation laid by my predecessor. My vision is to build an enviable professional institution of excellence by God's grace and with your support. To safeguard our core values, existence, aspiration, and progress. The first on my list of actions is to finish the revision of the constitution that the outgoing administration started. Currently, there are 5 standing committees. Rather than have people nominated to this committee, I'm proposing for volunteers who have a passion for each of these preferred committees to put themselves forward. In this regard, notices will go out to all members for those who want to serve, indicate their choices, which will then be put to the general meeting for ratification. I urge those with special skills to offer themselves to the specialized areas. I need to have a very strong editorial committee to support our agenda. Two extra ad hoc committees will be set up for now, and I believe when the revision of the constitution is completed, the two ad hoc committees will find places as permanent standing committees of the institution. These are the conferences and fundraising development committees. These are the conferences and fundraising development committees. The Committee on Conference will be the body that is tasked with displaying our wealth. This body will be tasked with organizing one local conference a year to coincide with our AGMs. The hosting of annual general meeting will be located initially among the cities or towns with public universities that offer geoscience programs.
our one international conference every 2 years. And I hope that the first one will come off in the third quarter of 2018. Two to three seminars or workshops each year for professional development of members. Four, public lectures to educate the general public on issues bordering on those science. Each radio / TV discussions on issues of national importance bordering on science. Introduction of active newsletter on quarterly basis. The next is revival of blue science publications. To do this, editorial and the conferences committees will have to work hand in hand. The other ad hoc committee is the fundraising and development, which will be responsible in finding ways to raise funds, not only for our building, but also to support all programs and activities of the institution. With your full involvement, we shall find innovative ways of raising all funds needed to effectively carry out our mandate. It will not be an easy work, but with strong resolve, dedication, and perseverance, we will succeed. I've noticed a new resolve and vibrancy of membership. With regards to the organization of this conference, I appeal to our consultants in the institution to underwrite the bill for the conference center and refreshment. The response has been outstanding. The target was exceeded. I stand here on behalf of the organizing committee and the new executive to say a big thank you to all contributors. I believe they have been deeply recognized in the program. Thank you, Dan. And our business will be conducted mainly by IT. And we have started investing it for the past 3 weeks. It has worked very beautifully. This is a very good start and a sign indeed of what is to come. The leadership intends to play a positive advocacy role in the development of our mineral, water, and petroleum resources. We have 600 plus registered members, and only about one sixth are in good standing. The new executive will work hard to impress this strength. The choice of the team and the keynote speaker is a confirmation of our dedication to finding a solution to this problem of illegal mining. I salute the media and the civil societies in their all-out work on illegal mining. The term here is illegal mining. The institution is ready to participate in finding solutions to the environmental damage to land, water, and water bodies, which are engaged with relevant bodies like the Ghana Institutions of Engineers and Surveyors, the Ministry of Lands and Natural Resources, the Water Commission, CSIR, Ghana Minerals Commission, and the EPA to involve solutions. The institution has also taken up the challenge to find alternative source of sand so as to stop the degradation of farmlands. In this direction, we shall liaise with the Institution of Engineers, Ministry of Lands and Natural Resources, Minerals Commission, EPA, and the Standard Board Authority. At the end of the day, what we need as a country is a good and sound land use and management plan. However, this will require a good coverage of the whole country with good regional, geological, geochemical, and geophysical maps. You will see the geological survey has this responsibility. This country, we have just over 40% of the country that is properly mapped. We have participated in a mapping project, my company, in 2005. There was a particular area before we went there, they told us there's nothing there. But after the mapping project, that place is showing such a high promise of other opportunity minerals. So if we have only around 40% of the country that is well mapped, what about the system? What is there? And it does not only affect minerals. I heard our learned professor, he says he's also interested in medical geology. This cannot be done without good geochemical, regional geochemical map covering the whole country. There are areas we have problems with health in certain areas because of the geology, the underlying geology. Soils, good soils, poor soils, they are a reflection of the rocks underneath. How do you choose a place for a particular kind of crop production when you don't have good geological map? And the list, we can go on and on. This is not the time. So we are calling for the Ghana Geological Survey Authority to be resourced adequately to carry out this function. These appear to be lofty ideas. But with your support and involvement of every one of us, the dreams are achievable. Long live the Ghana Institute of Geoscientists. Long live Ghana. Thank you.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. And we'd like to congratulate Alhaji Yakubu Idrisu as the current president. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to, at this moment, ask for the... We will at this moment ask for the chairman's closing remarks, and a few announcements will be made later on. So we'd like to invite Dr. B.C. Nakwam, the chairman for today's function. Please give him a round of applause.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'll be brief in my closing remarks. First of all, I'd like to thank all of you for being with us and cooperating with us to have a successful event. I personally am very delighted because I've been a long-standing member of this institution. I joined the It was a society. I joined in the 1980s. And in 1998, I became a fellow of the Ghana Institution of Geoscientists. So you can see that I've been with this institution for quite a long time. But because I traveled outside the country, some of you perhaps didn't know me, but together with Alhaji and Mrs. Alexandra, and Mr. Banning and others, we have had a long memory of things. What I take from today's introduction and speeches There are two things. That the country, even though it is endowed with a lot of natural resources, or minerals for that matter, we still do not know to what extent that we have. And as you all know, we are all geologists. For natural resources, in order to be able to, if you like, use it sustainably, you need to have a good assessment of that resource. And it cuts across all natural resources. If you don't know what you have, it's difficult to plan, and it's difficult to conserve, and it's difficult, or almost impossible, to use it sustainably. And so the role of the geologist when it comes to mineral resources, foundation, soils, agriculture, land use, name it, is, you know, is very important. What I take from Professor's lecture or presentation today, which I found brilliant, was he talked about tipping points. And to me, it comes as somebody who has dealt quite a bit in the environment, it comes as music to my ears. We have ecosystems which are on the verge of collapse in this country. These are documented. You go to CSIR, go to other places, and they will show you. Our water bodies, as I stated earlier, are being destroyed. And as I said earlier also, it's a sign that our environment, natural resources, are seriously degraded. We are near the tipping point in certain cases. We are certainly facing a crisis. And as professionals, I think our country needs us at this time. We cannot just sit by and then just talk. Let's offer our services to help so that the legitimate needs of our country will not be used, misused by others to destroy our heritage.
For myself and on behalf of the newly inducted executives, to say a massive thank you to our speakers, Professor and the Doctor, for gracing this occasion. I also want to say a big thank you to MIDI's past president, Mrs. Amako Mensah. I hold a deep sense of appreciation and respect for you. Thank you for paving the way for most of us ladies. And I'm sure that I speak for the ladies when I say she's a fantastic role model for all of us. Thank you, Madam. A big thank you to our sponsors for providing the logistics and the support for this program. And last, but in no way the least, a big thank you to all of you for taking time of your busy schedules to be with us today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Lucy. We'd like to now invite Reverend Father Sam Wood to say the closing prayer.
Shall we rise and pray?
We called you at the beginning to direct every aspect of this meeting. You have seen us through successfully. We give you thanks. But as you brought us in here, take us to where you have come from. We also have reframed outside to partake, to relax, and to give you thanks, food and drinks outside. Bless us all to live, serving you with the knowledge that you've given us in geoscience and others. Pray this to Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's hold on for a while.
Thank you.